sembla, podríem anar començant. Jo sóc Lluís Bertran, subdirector de recerca i de gestió de l'Escola d'Administració Pública. Avui tenim amb nosaltres la honorable senyora Sococa, també, doncs, finalment no ha pogut venir el cònsol de Polònia, també havíem previst, doncs, també alguna assistència que no ha pogut ser confirmada, però doncs, donar-vos la benvinguda a tots a l'escola. Bon dia a tothom. De fet, la conferència d'avui ens fa una especial il·lusió, no només pel tema, sinó perquè coincideix amb el número 50 de la Revista Catalana de Dret Públic i també amb el 30è aniversari d'aquesta mateixa revista. No? És per això que no és que es tracti avui d'una celebració específica o d'un acte específicament destinat a celebrar, doncs, que segurament ja ho farem més endavant, però sí que és una mica, doncs, una anticipació d'actes o jornades que intentarem fer per tal de celebrar i commemorar aquest 30è aniversari i aquest número 50 de la Revista Catalana de Dret Públic. Revista Catalana de Dret Públic, en la qual la senyora Sococa, doncs, ha tingut a bé presentar un article de la temàtica del que comentarà o del que farà la conferència posteriorment. I ara jo passaria la paraula a l'actual director de la Revista Catalana de Dret Públic, el senyor Josep Maria Castellà, perquè introduís breument també la revista i després ja passaríem a la presentació de la conferenciant i a la conferència. Gràcies.
Bon dia, moltes gràcies, senyor Bertran. És per mi un plaer estar en aquest acte i poder explicar-los com vam triar que la senyora Sococa pogués participar primer a la revista i després portar-la aquí. El Consell de Redacció de la Revista Catalana de Dret Públic va mirar d'organitzar amb tot el carinyo i al mateix temps amb, diguem-ne, tot el rigor i tot el prestigi al número 50. Volíem que el número 50 fos un número molt especial i el resultat el tenen des del mes de juny, quan puntualment va sortir, i entre els autors que hi participen hi ha la professora Sococa. El Consell vam pensar dues coses. Aquí demanar que participés en aquest número tan especial i al mateix temps quins temes ens interessarien. Un tema normalment absent a les revistes de dret públic a Espanya és l'Europa oriental, l'Europa central i oriental. Sabem molt d'Europa occidental, sabem molt d'Amèrica del Nord i del Sud, però entre els focus d'interès del dret públic, constitucional o administratiu, no hi és tant el que ha passat allà. I per tant, tenir una informació de primera mà, també coincidint amb el 25è aniversari de l'ensorrament del mur de Berlín i de les transformacions liberal-democràtiques dels països d'Europa de l'Est, doncs podia ser una bona oportunitat per posar sobre el tapet aquests països i els reptes que la democràcia i l'estat de dret va afrontar. Per això vam pensar amb una professora que combinés al mateix temps, diguem-ho així, dos vessants. D'una banda, el prestigi intel·lectual. La professora Sococa és catedràtica de dret constitucional a la Universitat de Potsdam, on es va formar, per tant, té una trajectòria acadèmica. Vull subratllar només que, en tant que acadèmica, ha dedicat una especial atenció als drets de les minories, i al mateix temps volíem que fos també una personalitat rellevant, diguem-ho així, de posar en pràctica aquelles idees constitucionals que havia estudiat i treballat i ensenyat. I per això pensàvem que era una persona que reunia aquests dos aspectes, en tant que membre de la comissió del Parlament que va elaborar la Constitució de Polònia, molt especialment la part dels drets humans, en tant que primera ministra de Polònia durant la presidència Wałęsa, després ministra de Justícia, després ambaixadora al Vaticà, i potser en el que lliga un aspecte i l'altre, la dimensió acadèmica i la dimensió política i diplomàtica és que és una dels membres fundadors i fa 25 anys que està a la Comissió de Venècia. La coneguda com Comissió de Venècia és la comissió per la democràcia a través del dret, per dir-ho exactament, a través de l'estat de dret, com a òrgan assessor del Consell d'Europa per treballar i fer informes sobre aquests temes. És una de les membres més rellevants i, per tant, té una perspectiva de tots els països, no només, per tant, de Polònia, on la Comissió de Venècia està treballant. I últimament la Comissió de Venècia està treballant molt tot el que passa, fins i tot a l'est de Polònia, pensem repúbliques caucàssiques, Ucraïna, Bielorússia, la mateixa Rússia, i també al sud, pensem l'ex Iugoslàvia, els països balcànics. Per tant, té un coneixement i un bagatge que pensàvem podria ser molt interessant. El resultat és l'article que els invito a mirar i com també fem la revista catalana de dret públic, cada número intentem fer una presentació seleccionant algun dels articles i algun dels autors que hi participen. I vam voler, primer inicialment, volíem que fos un acte més amb més participació d'altres autors, no ha pogut ser, i de moment sí que hem considerat molt important portar a la professora Sukok a Barcelona que ens expliqués aquests reptes de la democràcia i de l'estat de dret en els estats de l'Europa central i oriental, i per part meva res més, simplement agrair-li la presència, agrair a l'escola que hagi organitzat aquest acte i recordar el que ja sabem, que és una font d'inspiració, ha estat una font d'inspiració per generacions de polonesos. Ahir va fer una conferència a ESADE i a l'escola, a School of Law, a la Facultat de Dret d'ESADE, i els estudiants els va explicar una anècdota que no resisteixo a comentar-los i amb això acabo. Venint de Polònia, a l'avió es va trobar en una parella de joves que anaven a passar uns dies a Florència. I aquests joves es van adreçar amb ella i li van agrair el que havia fet quan era primera ministra, i ell li va dir, miri, jo vaig poder, gràcies a la liberalització, vaig poder muntar un negoci, vaig poder sortir endavant amb una empresa, ara podem tenir unes vacances, i per tant li va agrair el que personalment diguem-ne, havia afectat amb aquesta jove parella, doncs, la instauració d'una democràcia constitucional en el seu país. Això que ha estat font d'inspiració, per tant, per generacions de polonesos, és també un motiu que ens enorgulleix i que ens permet establir un diàleg entre Europa Occidental i Europa Oriental, ens permet conèixer millor el que són, sens dubte, les bases de la democràcia. La democràcia o és democràcia constitucional o no és democràcia, la democràcia lligada amb l'estat de dret són pilars fonamentals de les nostres societats, per tant, de la nostra civilització. Gràcies, professora Sukok, gràcies a l'escola, gràcies a tots vostès per la seva presència.
Gràcies, senyor Castellà. Mrs. Sukok, when you want to start the conference.
I have to check time. So, thank you so much. Now we turn to English. I am unable to speak Spanish. I was able to learn Italian, so it's very familiar to Spanish language, but then I said, no, I didn't try to learn Spanish because it's too familiar to Italians that I will never speak well Spanish language, learning my Italian so late, yes, not in the young my younghood, because being young, you can better learn languages than being a little, I can say, older. So for that reason, I decided to speak in English. As well that my paper was also published in both languages. Yes, as I know, only in English or only in English. So it's better because if somebody would like to read it, of course, has also to read it in English. But I would like to express my thanks for inviting me to Barcelona to be here today and yesterday with students. And I can say that I didn't expect it yesterday, that the meeting with students would be so interesting, that the young people there are so interested in the development of the Central European history. So it was for me a very, very good meeting and a lot of questions. I think that probably in our part of Europe, students are much more, how to say, bombarded by the information concerning development in Central Eastern Europe, even between different political parties and the discussion what was good, what was bad, and how was exactly the whole process. So maybe they are not so very happy to discuss the issues. But here it was a different situation. And now I would like also to say something from the history, as I've written in my paper, but also maybe to put a question: what is a future for Europe, and not only for Europe, but what we can do with the whole transformation? Just 2 months ago, I was invited to have a lecture in Austria, in one of the American universities in Austria. And they put me a question. It was entitled in this way. I have to repeat because I took the question directly from the university. After communism, is the West's democracy of today the solution for Eastern Europe's tomorrow? It was such a question, but I changed the question and I said that we have to put the question much more broad way. After communism, is the West's democracy of today the solution for Europe tomorrow, not only Eastern Europe's? Because we are now all living in one Europe, in united Europe, and we have to look for common solutions and answer the question how far we can find the solutions and ideas and hopes in the future building new Europe. And as it has been said here, my topic and my personal professional topic were always constitutions, constitutional law, constitutions, different countries. So I tried to analyze the situation in Central Europe and in Europe through the development of constitution and constitutionalism. Of course, being a member of the Venice Commission, so-called Venice Commission, and the official name, this has been said, is democracy through law. It is also the task to analyze constitution and to see how the constitution can develop, can help to develop the political system in the countries and vice versa, how the political system in the given country or countries can also influence the changes in the constitution. So I think that in Central and Eastern Europe, in the beginning especially of transformation, in the beginning of 90s, we had a very clear study of this process, which was written by Ferdinand Lassalle in his speech, Essence of the Constitution, because he exactly made this theory on the Constitution and said that written Constitution is nothing, because it should be based on the real constitution, which are the relationships in society. So we could observe that exactly it was the case in many post-communist countries or countries being in transition in the beginning of 90s. And now we can also observe the situation, we can analyze the situation in some other countries like Ukraine, which is still in the process of making amendments to the constitutions, and also other countries in Central and Eastern Europe, they also try to make amendments, change their constitutions. It's a still very interesting process. So I think that we can see in this period of 25 years between 1989 and now 2015, so it's almost 16 years, 26 years, we can see such two periods which I noticed. The beginning, it was the looking for a new constitution, for making amendments to the constitution, to look, I will say something more on this process, to put the so-called all socialist communist constitution on the way of democratic constitutions built on the model of Western democracy. And now, since probably 10 years, we can observe such a situation that some countries in post-communist countries, in the group of post-communist countries, they would like to make their own amendments to the constitution, which are, how to say, specifically rooted in their tradition and looking for new solutions in the countries. I don't know if it's we can call that it is a clear tendency for the future, but some exams we can observe now. I mentioned only two countries, for example, Ukraine, now Albania, even Macedonia would like to make some amendments to the constitution, very specific amendments to the constitution. Hungary, it's exactly one of the examples. And I think that it also gives us a raise for the discussion on the not only post-communist constitutions, but sometimes I use such a term, post-transformation constitutions, because maybe it's a new phenomena, how the new constitutions in post-transformation countries should be amended, should be built, should be established, and should be implemented. Saying all this, I try to make such a framework, to make a framework of my speech, but as normally we start with the beginning, of transformation. So I also I did it in my paper, but I also try to point out now that in the beginning we had to make a very clear difference between a notion of democratization and democracy. So I started my paper with these two words. Because, for example, in a socialist system, I use a socialist system, but maybe it's better to use communist system, because socialist system has a positive connotation in Western democracy. It depends, of course, on who is taking the power. But in communist system, we avoided to use the term living in communism. We avoided to use the term communist system, but we use the term socialism, yes, or real socialism. Because communism was, it was not described by Fukuyama, but by Marx, it was the best system in the world. And our goal was to build communism, and in living in a communist part of the Europe, we didn't believe that we are still a communism, yes? It was our expectations, our leaders, communist leaders' expectations, probably not completely fully convinced that finally we will live in a communism paradise. So for that reason, we didn't use the term communist constitution, communist system, but socialist. So as you see, being educated in that time, I still am using this term, but I should rather say on communist constitution. And so in communist time, we never said that we try to build democracy or real democracy, because it was sure for leaders and in official propaganda that we had democracy. We had democracy, People's Republic democracy. And it was called that we have socialist democracy, which is higher than Western bourgeois democracy. You can find a lot of such things. So for that reason, we could only saying on democratization, that there is a democracy, but we can do something better, something more, to democratize our system, even make more, yes? So being democracy, having democracy, but to try democratize more. So the different discussions and official propaganda used the term democratization, democratization. And then it was also the first difference between the official propaganda and oppositionist parties or groups, because the opposition openly said that no, we don't need to democratize the system. We have to build democracy in our country. We have to build real democracy. But it was not allowed to openly to say it such a way. So it was the first, how to say, discrepancy between the official propaganda and the language which was used by opposition. That the opposition said in the beginning also democratization, democratization, but then step by step, now we have to build real democracy. I put to my article, I try to touch my paper only in a very short way, differences between two emotion, but then it was clearly seen how the definition divided the two groups. Because in time of the round table agreements, when opposition decided, we can say opposition from Solidarity, decided to start round table talks with representatives of Communist Party, the common base was democratization. And opposition decided, okay, we can agree on democratizations because it was important to sit together and to start the discussion. And as I said, that in February 1989, it was the main guiding line was still democratization. Democratization because open a way for making roundtable agreement. And finally, in April, the roundtable agreement has been signed, and it was commonly said that now we can make and we can introduce more democratizations to our country. What was the result? After the roundtable agreement in April 1989, there was the elections in June 1989, but elections, as we know, semi-democratic, semi-free elections, because to Senate, who was newly created in Poland, elections were completely free, but to Sejm, the elections were prescribed and agreed before the final result. The seats were divided between Communist Party and Communist Party Alliance and Solidarity opposition members. The seats were divided, but of course, not the persons. It was for the first time votes for concrete persons to the parliament. And in this semi-democratic election, Solidarity won almost 100% seats in Senate because one person was elected which was not member of Solidarity but was completely independent, not coming from Communist Party. So 100 seats in Senate have been taken by opposition, and in Parliament all seats reserved for opposition had been taken by Solidarity members. And it was also one important fact that in that time in Poland we had so-called state list of candidates. Yes, it is an institution which is well known in electoral systems of different countries, that people vote not only in the region, but also they gave voices on so-called state list. And on state list there were the most important politicians coming from different parties. And communists proposed also to include to the list representatives of Solidarity. But Solidarity leaders refused. So in the elections in June 1989, we had state lists, but on the state list, they were only names of communist leaders coming from different foreign ministers, secretary of Communist Party, ministers, and all important people. It was 46 names, probably, as I remember, probably 10%. But finally, the result was an electoral campaign. It was such a call to, how to say, delete all the, voted against all the persons being on the state list. And it has happened. Only two persons from the state list receive enough number of votes to enter to the parliament. It was the last person on the list, Zieliński. He was in that time chief of the administrative court, and somebody said that he found it in parliament only because the line was not done to the end, yes? Because when they make such an X on the list, probably the last point of the line didn't touch name Zieliński. That is, was the last name of the list. So he entered into the parliament. And he was exactly extremely good because he was professor of law and specialist in administrative law and very critical to many different institutions. But what has happened? Because the leaders of former communist parties and coalitions, because also from other parties which were in coalition with communists, they didn't receive enough number of votes, they didn't enter to the parliament. They were not elected to parliament. So in parliament then we had such a situation. Solidarity went to parliament with their leaders and the post-communist groups without leaders. So then everything was possible. Everything was possible because the members of Communist Party being in parliament without leaders or leaders were outside, they were not obliged to follow the directed party line. They tried to do something, but they felt themselves much more weak than before. And so for that reason, for solidarity, it was much, much easier not only to convince them, I can say, but to make a pressure for them, yes, to vote in this way as solidarity would like to vote. And then, because as I started, the whole round table agreement, I don't know, sometimes we call agreements because there were many points, were based on the, as I said, main guideline, democratization. And democratization was opening a way for solidarity to run for elections, but in very limited space. Democratization was also seen that we will have a new, old, new institution of president, because president, institution of president did not exist in 1989 in Polish system, but then it was agreed that president will be established, re-established in the Polish system, and Senate. Senate was reserved for the free elections, so it was such a highly expectation by solidarity groups that in Senate we'll have a majority. We never expected that we'll have 100% in Senate. It was only such a feeling that maybe our impression we'll have majority of seats instead of parliament in same lower house when we had only 33% of seats. So for that reason, Senate and president were a new institution of balancing of powers, because Senate was seen as a free body and ensure who will be elected to be a member of Senate. And president in roundtable agreements has been agreed that it will be somebody from Communist Party, and he will be a guarantor of the continuity of the communist system in the country with new elements of democratization. But it was an agreement. But then we had a real fact. A real fact was election in June 1989, the completely, how to say, using computer language, deleting of the state list, and no leaders of communists in parliament, and very strong role played by solidarity groups in parliament. So from this day, from the month, from June 1989, I say, and I always argue, that it was the beginning of a real transformation in Poland. The roundtable agreements and the discussion in the roundtables, they opened the way. They created atmosphere and gave a ground for making elections. But then, after election, it was the beginning of completely new thinking and new transformation process in Poland. And I think that from this moment, nobody used the argumentation on democratization, but on real democracy in the country. That we have to put away the word democratization, but we have to discuss how and what kind of democracy we would like to build in our society. And then as a result of the June elections, it was impossible to elect a candidate for prime minister from governing from Communist Party, because it was also one of the points of roundtable agreement that president as well as prime minister, they both came from, would be members of Communist Party. And Jaruzelski was elected as a president, but only by one vote. It was a strong discussion, yes? The vote was valid or not valid. I remember the whole problems and nervous situation. What could happen if Jaruzelski would not be elected as a president? But finally, he was elected because some members of Solidarity were convinced not to vote for him, but not to vote for nobody, yes, to give not valid votes. So for that reason, it was possible to elect Jaruzelski by one vote. So, okay, it one guarantor was done as it was prescribed in the roundtable agreement. But the second step was impossible to be done, to be agreed. And the candidate for prime minister was never agreed. It was proposed a candidate for prime minister, Kiszczak, who, by the way, died yesterday. And he was proposed to be prime minister, but parliament was completely unable to adopt it, to accept it. And he was unable to make a government. So I remember the very funny situation, because at that time I was a member of parliament elected from the Solidarity list, when I observed the communist ministers, because previous government made resignations after elections in June, but they were still seated in the governmental benches because it was impossible to find a new candidate, to accept a new candidate for prime minister and to elect a new government, yes? So it was very strange situations. And finally, in August, Wałęsa, who was at the time leader of Solidarity, he decided and said, no, we have to create a new coalition, and the coalition with Solidarity and two alliance party before alliance party to communist regime, but now they change their mind and join the Solidarity. So in this situation, we received a majority and a new candidate for prime minister was proposed, Tadeusz Mazowiecki. And I think that in this situation, Mazowiecki was adopted in September 1989, and he created the first non-communist government with some communist in this Council of Ministers, but he was a leader and he was a chief first non-communist leader of the government. So I gave the situation, I gave the history, tried to describe the history, because it was exactly the new beginning, we can say. Completely new situation, not agreed in the round table agreements. And then what was obvious? It was obvious that now we have to amend the constitution, because we still have in constitution some provisions which were completely, how to say, not adapted to the current situation. First of all, we had a provision that Sejm, the lower house of parliament, is the highest body in the system of state organs. No, it was completely impossible because it was not high body now because it was only one of the two chambers in parliament. Then it was also such a provision in the constitution that president, new elected president, he will be guarantor, as I said, of the communist regime in the country, and he will have a power to dissolve parliament in the situation when parliament would like to make such steps which generally saying will be against the continuation of the existing system in the country. And then Jaruzelski, as elected as president, he observed many situations. For example, the election of a non-communist prime minister, a new government which was created by non-communist members, and the new, completely new program presented by Mazowiecki, and he did nothing, yes? He didn't decide to solve parliament because in this political situation, this constitutional guarantees served for nothing. It was not possible for Jaruzelski to use this guarantee, so he accepted everything, and he was the only person who was, how to say, remains of the roundtable agreements, but the whole world, political world around, had been changed completely. And then, as a consequence of the whole transformation, of the whole changes, it was important to make amendments to the constitution in December 1989. Because Mazowiecki, government of Mazowiecki, prepared completely new economic program. It was the main issue. Balcerowicz, Leszek Balcerowicz, as a minister of finance as, and vice prime minister of the Mazowiecki's government, he decided to introduce to Poland the normal economic system, yes, the free market economy instead of the condemned economy and based on the state ownership industry and all means of production. So for that reason, to open the way for Balcerowicz program, it was a need to change the constitution, to amend the constitution, because in the constitution we had still such a provision on the priority of the state ownership in our political and economic system. So in this situation, we changed. We organized in a very quick way the discussion on the constitution. I was at the time member of the Legislative Commission, but also Constitution Commission, but Legislative Commission was crucial in this sense. And I remember that we were sitting with some experts from the constitutional law and some lawyers from the Constitutional Commission in Parliament and expert outside of Parliament, and we discussed what kind of principle we have to include to the Constitution. But of course, we are sure that we make only provisional constitution. We have to make our new full constitution, so we decided to put only some general principles which could change, which could give base for the new system, and then we'll discuss on new constitution. And in this sense, we introduced to the constitution very important rule, which was not before. For example, the rule of law, that Poland will be state ruled, having as a general principle rule of law, and also social, how it is in English, even I lost the word Polish, economy, social economy, yes, the elements of social economy. How it is the definition in German, because this was done by one of our experts who was specialist in German law. So he proposed such a formula, which is very, very well known from the German constitution, and we put it into our constitution. And this formula exists now, because it was repeated in the constitution from 1997. But it opens the way for two things. For a new program of Balcerowicz, economic program, because it was a state of rule of law, but with the element of based on social economy aimed at social and society. And then, of course, we decided to cut the provisions on the ruling role of the Communist Party, because it was still constitutional provision that the Communist Party plays a leading role in the political system. So in this such a provision, it was impossible to build a pluralistic society, and it was impossible to open the way for pluralism, party pluralism. And then we also had to cancel from the constitution, to eliminate from the constitution, the provision which said on the friendship between Soviet Union. So because it was also such a constitutional provision which was common for all communist constitution in all countries. When we did it, we decided to change the name of the country also, coming back to our traditional name, which is completely not translated into English, because in English the old name and the new name means the same way, because we have in Polish Rzeczpospolita Polska, which could be translated as a republic, yes, and not translated into English language, but for us it was a traditional historical name of Poland. So for that reason we introduced it to the constitution. So it was the end of the year, December 1989. So I said, I concentrate myself in this first part, but then I have several minutes for further discussion, that we started to make the change and we created a base for future amendments. We did it everything, as you know, in period when around us we had still only communist countries, Russian troops on our territory, and still DDR, Czechoslovakia, and Soviet Union existed as a state countries. And you know, always when we are then making the and showing on the difference between the starting point in 1989 and later on, we say that in the beginning we had only three neighbors, but then after we had much more neighbors, because many countries, how to say, split it into individual independent countries. For example, DDR became a part of Western Germany. It was a different thing, but a border remained as it was. But Czechoslovakia split it later on to different countries, Slovak Republic and Czech Republic. So instead of having one neighboring country in the south, we then had two countries. And Eastern border was much more, how to say, splitted, because then we had a border with Russia on the north, Kaliningrad. We have border with Lithuania, with Belarusia, with Ukraine. So you see so many countries instead of one Soviet Union. So it also showed in this sense that we created a pluralistic, much more pluralistic and completely different world based on the smaller but independent autonomous countries. And then the revolution after 1989 started in other countries. They have decided to follow their own way, but to some extent even to follow the Polish way, but it was not completely possible to follow the Polish way, because we had exactly a very strong solidarity movement and the other countries, they were not so strongly reorganized in communist time. There was a very strong movement in Czechoslovakia, Karta 77, and we had a very strong, good cooperation between Solidarity and Karta, Charter 77, and it was a crucial role played in the situation by Václav Havel, who was a very good friend to all leaders of Solidarity, and he supported us, and then we supported him when he was elected as a president of Czechoslovakia, and then after split of Czechoslovakia, he resigned. He was not a president. He was in such a time between one presidential office and then not yet elected as a president of Czech Republic. And I remember him when he came to Poland at that time, and we had such a common evening. It was very popular at that time to invite the people, Václav Havel, Geremek, me and others. We are sitting and talking, drinking, etc., etc. And Havel was such a nice man, and we are asking him, would you like to run for presidential elections again? And he said, so, you know, he called me always Hanička. My name is Hanna, but he called me Hanička. You know, Hanička, when the politics t- take the one, you are ever, forever in his hands. Yes, so for that reason, it was his answer that he will run for the presidential election, and he did it. And he was exactly, as we know, a very good president, but I think that he was not so strongly convinced as concerns the division of Czechoslovakia. Because he was of the opinion that it would be better to run one country or to find, I don't know, a kind of agreement between two parts to create a strong autonomy, I don't know, regionalism or federation or something like that, but to keep one country. But it has happened because the politicians in Slovakia, they had a very strong tendency to create independent state. It has happened, yes. In Hungary, the revolution had completely different different impact. And as we discussed before we enter here, as you said, that Hungary was probably the most open to the West. Independence. I think Hungary and Poland, we are the two countries which were seen as a most Western European countries. And also one digression here, and that's my long speech. When I was in Heidelberg in 85, in Heidelberg Max Planck Institute, and suddenly one of the professors or foreign professor and who was in the Heidelberg in the same house as I was said to me and said, have you seen here's somebody from DDR? He came with his car from DDR here. And I said, no, what's news? Nothing. I also came from Poland with my own car here. You Poles, you are everywhere. But from DDR, coming to Western Germany, it's a sensation, yes? So we didn't know that it was such a strict division between those two countries. So then it was, of course, creation of fall of Berlin Wall was exactly an important change because it was, how to say, completely, how to say, creation of a country on a completely new ground, and it was a need to build a country which was built on completely different mentalities, and it was also a big challenge for Western Germany. But as a rich country, it was much easier, and we had to do everything by ourselves. And in this case, I come back to Hungary, because in Hungary was exactly very well prepared before transformation, because Hungary tried to find such a liberal economic elements in the socialist economy, communist economy, to open the way for giving, how to say, more freedom for individuals to make economy, etc., etc. So it has happened in till 1989, and then after transformations, when Hungary entered to the way of transformation 1990. The Hungary changed a little perception. Economy in Hungary was not the main issue in the beginning of transformation because it was still this thinking that we have enough strong economy to make transformation. And Prime Minister Antal, who was a real personality in the time, Prime Minister Antal, he was, I can say, maybe somebody said that is not true, but to some extent, he was a grandfather of the ideas which are now developed by Orban. Because Antal was very open, but he was of the opinion that the main issue is to build a strong Hungarian identity. And for him it was important to build strong Hungarian roots, Christian roots. He was very strongly convinced that it should be important to build Christian roots. And he was not so strongly attached to making economic change, development, but mental change in Hungarian society. I had a very good cooperation with Antal because his father was one of the participants of the Warsaw upheaval during the Second World War. So we had a very good connotation. And exactly with Antal, we had always very, very good talks, very good contacts, but not on the economy, only on history of the region, on history of our countries, and his idea was to build a strong Central European group. So he was one of the inventors of Visegrad Group. He, Havel, and there was the people, they thought that we have to find our common ground and try to build strong European, Central European groups, because we are not sure it would be possible for us to enter to the European Union, then European community, and when. So we tried to organize ourselves in the Central Europe to show to Western leaders that we are also able to do something and to create such a regional organization. The Visegrad Group exists now, but as we know, with some problems, but now the problems are common for also for bigger groups like European Union. But it was in the beginning. In the beginning, we had our common tendency to build democracy in all countries, real democracy. And as I have written in my paper, we would like to create a democratic system with the all traditional values, because we called it return to traditional democratic principles as sovereignty of nations, free elections, guarantee of human rights, dignity of human person, separation of powers, and important independence of judiciary. I don't touch, and I am unable, of course, to say something more on all the issues, because it will take me more 3 hours. But I try to go to the end, but saying only this, then there were the general principles we agreed around that we would like follow this way. But then we see since 25 years, the definition of the general principles is sometimes, differently interpreted in different countries. And for that reason, separation of powers. We can observe now the different instrument used in different countries for defining separation of powers. In Hungary, it means something else. In Romania, we observe the situation, the tension between Basescu and Ponta, and then finally, after 4 years of the battle with Basescu, Ponta resigned. We have now a different definition of separation of powers, especially in the countries when one party won absolute majority, or even worse, qualified majority. Because then, practically, separation of powers doesn't exist, because everything is in the hand of one political power. When it's in the hand of one political power, then it's difficult to say on the real separation of powers, yes? What kind of instruments should be used to guarantee the separation of power? And even worse with the independence of judiciary. Because independence of judiciary, it was the main, principle. It was said since the beginning from the Council of Europe, European Union, that without independence of judiciary, without creating of independent judiciary, it would be impossible exactly to build a fully democratic society which is built on the Western principles. And it was one of the most difficult problems. And why? Because too early, the principle independence of judiciary had been included to the political system of the post-communist countries. And what was the effect? Effect was that all corrupted judges have been guaranteed independence of judiciary, and then the system didn't work, because if somebody would like to say that the judge should be eliminated, went to the process of evaluation, it was the main argument. No, we are independent. It is independent of judiciary. And now, 25 years after, we face the problem in the Venice Commission. We are both members of the Venice Commission, and we face the problem in the Venice Commission, that we have countries in Council of Europe group, because there are countries that are members of the Council of Europe. They have the slogan of independence of judiciary, and because it was such a strong tendency coming from European organs to guaranteed the independence of judiciary, and European institutions did not allow for solving, for how to say, elimination of judges from the office and replaced by others, because it was against the principle of the independence of judges. So now we have a situation in many countries, I don't like mention the names, where the judges are so corrupted, and they are so corrupted not only because European Union or European institutions did it, but they are exactly corrupted because the leaders of the country said that we can do nothing because judges are corrupted. And this is a situation which opened a new way. For example, now for the Venice Commission, it is also a new sign that we have to accept as a European institution some extraordinary measure to make evaluation of judges 25 years since the process of transformation began. But it is also a lesson for all of us. And as I said in the beginning, when we would like to say and to say yes for the general question, does the Western democracy after communists is also a solution for Europe of tomorrow, we have to say, yes, it is a solution for Europe of tomorrow, but maybe we have also to be more flexible, not to completely cancel or to go far away from the democratic principle, but try to give them such an interpretation and find such a solutions and institutions to create exactly a new situation in the countries, especially in the whole area of independence of judiciary and separation of powers, because it is also one of the problems and fears for the Venice Commission that now in many countries having at power one party with, as I said, absolute majority or maybe qualified majority, this situation could create a kind of authoritarian thinking in democratic framework. Because, you know, when it's one party, we can do everything. We can change constitution as we wish in any moment. So it is also a problem what kind of guarantees and what kind of limits should be taken in the situation when there is such a strong one party who is able to eliminate all minorities parties being in parliament. Because we would like to create a system in the beginning, 25 years ago, based on separation of power, of powers, on pluralistic thinking, pluralistic political party system. And now, maybe we are back in the beginning where this one party very strong, and of course we can do nothing because it's done in democratic way now by society. So how to find a field for agreement, how to look for compromise in such a society, not imposed to such a will of one party to everybody. But it is one of the most difficult problems in practice of post-communist countries. There are many problems, but I only would like to touch some of them. And at the moment, I'll finish, yes, because I think that, but you asked me to say so long, so thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you for your attendance. And now I think that maybe you will give me some comments or opinions for my work for the future. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for your words, Mrs. Sukoka. Well, to start now, we would open the turn of the audience, just to break the ice and to start with it. We probably agree that the quality of our democracies, it's always at stake. No? So we have to be very vigilant, very alert of what's going on with our democracies. In fact, that's what you also mentioned in your article. There are three pillars for democracy. It's the free election, the free vote. There's also the rule of law. And then it's human rights. Here in this country, we're having lately a big debate, a big discussion on the tension created by the rule of law and democracy. No? That's probably linking with your last comments of what's happening also in some Eastern countries, Eastern European countries, where people vote, give a majority of vote for a strong leadership, and this this leadership gains and holds a very strong presidential power and undermines democracy itself. But all it's done because of democracy, of the free vote, no? But at the same time, you're undermining. And well, I would like to know what's your view on this tension of these two principles of democracy, and also what's your point of view of how democracy is developing in the EU, in the European Union, since it happens a bit the same, no? Sometimes in these Eastern countries, they vote for a strong leadership, mainly because of security or because a national pride and so on. No? But in Europe, probably it's done, in the EU, it's probably done because of, in the name of efficiency, no? For instance, no? There are plenty of authorities, political authorities, which are not elected directly by the peoples of Europe. And, well, this, I understand that this weakens, or this could weaken the construction of real democracy in the European Union. What's your point of view on that?
It's I can say that on European Union should be a separate separate discussion, yes, because it's a topic per se now, I think, in the current Europe, in the current world, because we have here different levels. I concentrate myself on the eastern center, eastern European countries, and I when I thought on the threats for towards democracy in this part, I thought that it is probably so dangerous because in this part of Europe for more than 40 years we had an authoritarian system, so still the remnants of the totalitarian authoritarian systems are rooted in thinking of some leaders, even opposition leaders, yes, because for many of them, especially in the beginning, it was probably only such a, the main idea was that we have to take a power, and then we'll rule in the same way, yes, but it should be it was the perception of changing only the, how to say, bearer of power, yes? I think that the very good example of such a perception is Lech Wałęsa. Lech Wałęsa, he would like to change the system. But in my opinion, deeply, he was not so fully, how to say, convinced that democracy is the best rule, yes? And I can give you an example. When I received in Parliament the motion of non-confidence to my government, and Wałęsa was the Prime Minister, and I called him and I said, "Mr. President, I have to give you my after elections. Yes, I have to give you my resignation." Because I received motion of the confidence in May, and then we had elections, etc. The electoral campaign. Elections were in autumn, in September. Yes, and I said him, call him. Now after elections, I see that my party didn't receive majority, and you have to create a new government. I have to make this mission. He didn't like to receive me, and finally I would like look for him. Yes, to meet him. Finally, I found him in Parliament. Went to his cabinet and said, "Mr. President, I have to give you my resignation. How we can organize it?" You know, it was 93, so beginning of transformation. And he said to me, "Do you think that you have to do it?" I said, "Of course, because it's written in the Constitution." You have to do after election, when party didn't receive majority, former prime minister has to resign, even in case we receive majority. You have to open the new chapter, yes? I have to give you my resignation and see that. But maybe we can do it such a way. You will stay a prime minister, I will not take your dismission, and you will govern a country. I said, my God, president, it's impossible in the light of the constitution. But he said to me, I see that you don't have a will to govern the country. So it was the final response of Lech Wałęsa. So it was his kind of thinking, yes? You have a power, you have to keep it. And then we only have to find such tricky things, how to do it, as you said, rule of law and efficiency, rule of law and democracy, etc. Yes? Rule of law we have to interpret in this way to create efficient government, yes? And then, it was only one anecdote, but it has happened also, in my opinion, in Romania. It was 2010, I don't remember because the dates go so quickly, when in the term of 1 week in Romania, they, how to say, change all persons building the main institutions. Because as you remember maybe, Prime Minister, after election, he would like decided on the impeachment of president of the country and to decide on the leaving post from Basescu. But in the Romanian system, there were many institutions that built in the rule of law and guarantees that it was not so easy to say, okay, you have to go. So the Romanian system, they carefully analyzed what are the institutions they have to guarantee to Basescu his position to remain as a president, who can, how to say, make a negative opinion or maybe even send a case to the Constitutional Court or so. And they decided step by step in 1 week recall all the person from the office. Everything was done in the light of the Constitution, yes? Speaker of the same was replaced, speaker of the different institutions. I think that even ombudsman was recalled because ombudsman could, how to say, send a motion that it was not constitutional. Everything has been changed. New persons coming from the same party were, how to say, elected. And then the situation was, how to say, calm. But then finally, in the last moment, they tried to change even law on referendum to give possibility to make decision in referendum, but at the final moment, Constitution Court say no to some provisions of referendum, and finally, the Basescu, how to say, kept and returned to the office because of the decision done in referendum. But when we analyze, it was a long step. I sometimes have to put to my paper, different steps. 3rd of July, this person was recalled. 4th, this. 5th, this. It was in 1 week time, such a, how to say, chain of persons recalled to open the way for, how to say, deciding on the Basescu presidency. So it was also a very clear sign that now the ruling and very strong party would like to keep the rule of law, not to be attacked that is completely against rule of law, so rule of law written text of the Constitution, but the essence, the spirit of the decision was completely against the idea of constitutionalism, yes? What does mean? That constitutionalism means also in the history a certain rules that should be preserved, and not only written rules, but also, how to say, a kind of behavior that should be preserved in the country. It was completely neglected. And then we observe also the situation in, for example, in Hungary, in making a new constitution, because of such a big majority, Orban and the party said, we have to create efficient system, and of course, we have a power, we are acting in the rule of law, with in line with the rule of law, But having qualified majority, we can change everything. So here's the question, as I said in the end of my, how far, having qualified majority, we are able to change everything? Yes, probably not, because there are such pillars that should be kept in democratic society. And the rule of law is only an instrument who is, how to say, a kind of guarantee that democracy will be developed in the certain limits, yes, not interpreted in such a, how to say, extraordinary way. But we observe the situation. So for that reason, probably the role of Venice Commission is so important. And sometimes I wonder that that some countries ask us for the opinion, and they would like exactly to keep the track between democracy and rule of law. We will observe what will happen in Ukraine, because Venice Commission gave its opinion now on judiciary, amendments to the Constitution on judiciary, also made opinion on the amendments on decentralization of the country. And now I think that in Ukraine there is a common agreement on judiciary. But in Ukraine example showed, because in Ukraine there is no majority for the governing party, and president would like to play more, how to say, decisive role. But in Ukraine, they have to look for compromises, for voices in parliament to accept the constitutional amendments. And now I hope, I'm not so sure, that in Ukraine they found the enough majority for adopting the amendments to the judiciary. But probably, there will be a problem with adopting a part onto the Constitution on decentralization. And you know it better than all of us, yes, how difficult is this issue. And especially in Ukraine, when they would like to establish a real decentralization, real autonomy. And what does mean? How to explain what does mean real autonomy? It could also create a lot of problems. And now we probably will see the discussion, which is based on the arguments coming from, based on the rule of law, and others who will argue that in this situation we have to see and concentrate ourselves on efficiency and trying to give, how to say, the new impact for development of the country. And now in the European Union, I talk so much on Eastern countries, because, you know, in Western European countries, the mechanisms were much more clear. And in the societies of Western democracies, the authoritarian thinking was not so strongly rooted like in our part of Europe. So it was easier, and in your country probably, maybe not probably countries, not country, not Spain, but in Western countries, the how to say, meaning and feeling of the democratic institutions and balance and separation of powers, it's much strongly rooted. So there, here is not such a danger like in our countries. And you are always, how to say, acting in the traditional meaning of a rule of law, because rule of law was always a basis for in your constitution and for development in your country. And now it's a question, what with European Union? Because as we know it very well, the call for more democracy in European Union is still since the beginning. It was always such a critics that the deficiency of democracy in European Union. So for that reason, now since the Treaty of Lisbon, we have a stronger role of parliament, but nobody knows exactly effect how strong is the role of parliament. Yes, but the parliament probably is much more visible. But members of parliament, European parliament, are completely unknown in our country. For them, I don't know how it is in Spain, but they are completely unknown. Once elected, they completely, how to say, are out of the screen. Then it's a discussion, what exactly is the direction for the European Union itself, how it should be organized. We can hear now a lot of voices that European Union should be more decentralized, but it should be clearly described what does mean for the European Union to be decentralized, to give to whom more power, to individual states. Sometimes we can read that that no to individual states, but maybe to such an territorial organizations, yes, as we said, regional organizations, which are created not in one country, but on the ground of several countries. And to be less bureaucratic, because we see that now the bureaucratic decision of the European are contested by different countries. So it is a way that European Union should think how far the decentralizations and kind of de-bureaucratization of European Union is possible in this time, which is so difficult, yes? On the one side, we need a clear policy of European Union concerning exactly the crucial issue for Europe, and we need a common policy based on ground, as I said, always solidarity. But on the other hand, we have to also think how far and what kind of decision should be decentralized. We have to maybe again verify the different fields of decision, different areas, and then to discuss on the new division of powers, because otherwise there will be the situation that some small countries will make a pressure for European Union, and then will be policy from time to time only done, yes, from one case to another case. So it should be done something, but the time is not so, how to say, maybe opportune for making such a decision, and European Union would like to keep the power, but then the decision of European Union are contested by individual countries.
Preguntes? Algú vol fer alguna pregunta? Sí, endavant, director.
Yes, hello, I'm Manuel Manonelles, the Director General for Multilateral Affairs of the Catalan Government. So first of all, I would like to thank Dr. Shukoka for her very interesting intervention and speech, and also for the magazine of international of public law, the Catalan, well, La Revista Catalana de Dret Públic, for organizing this event together with l'Escola d'Administració Pública de Catalunya. And again, thank you for your very interesting speech and for this BU, which has some interesting aspects also about the history and the practical evolution of the transition in Poland. Since I think that we don't have that much time for the timing, I just wanted to ask you if you would have to put some headlines of the two or three main challenges that democracy has in East and Central Europe. And from your point of view, and also for the point of view of the work of the Venice Commission, I think that for us is quite interesting, because here, of course, we have our own challenges at our national level, but also from Barcelona, we also have a very strong look at the Mediterranean dimension. So usually we focus much more on the Euro-Mediterranean dimensions, and then you can imagine that the challenges of democracy in the Mediterranean, it's another category, and with a very strong different reality than the one in Central and Eastern Europe. So for us, although you have described it already in your intervention in some details, in some areas, if you should put the two or three main challenges that democracy faces in Central and Eastern Europe, if you could tell us from this perspective, and if you think that these challenges are shared in the different areas, because I think that maybe the challenges are a bit different in the different parts of the Visegrad group, but also more in the eastern part of Europe, which are not part of the Visegrad group. Thank you.
Thank you for very interesting question. But exactly, as you said, for countries like I spent 12 years in Italy. Yes, So for Italian, it's the same from Spain. Now the main problem is South European neighborhood. Yes, it was 12-10 years ago, not such a how to say. It was always important, but it was not such a hot question that it became now. And being in Italy, I fully understood this problem, because it was since years Italians and Italian government always ask the, how to say, common immigration policy from European Union, yes? It was the call done by Italians in time when it was not such a massive wave of immigration, but it was a massive immigration to Italy. So Italy was remain itself alone, yes? And so for that reason, the Italian government always called for help coming from European Union and said, we are, one of our principles is solidarity, so help us, because we have nothing, we can nothing to do with this wave of immigration. We are ready to help them, but in which way? And I think that in that time, it was just 6-7 years ago, the European Union organized discussion on the immigration, but in much more, how to say, such a typical political role, not preparing a real action plan for the future. So it was a clear lack of action plan for the future. And then, after the Arab Revolution, it was obvious that the countries, new countries, the democracy, how to say, creates a new problem, creates new problems. The problems completely unknown in previous regimes, yes? Because in authoritarian regimes, it's easier. Somebody, how to say, close the freedom of speech, freedom of movement, and everything is solved, yes? But when the European countries and Western countries wider decided to enter, to make, to help, to make revolution in Arab countries, it should be also the answer on the solution, what we can do in case when. It was clearly said by Holy See in that time. I followed the policy of the Holy See. It was the beginning, because the war in Iraq was in the time of John Paul II, and John Paul II was so strongly against the war in Iraq. He argued that it would not be solution, that it will create danger for the future, not only continent, but for the whole region. And you know what we have now, 10 years after? As Tony Blair said several weeks ago, that it was a fault to enter to Iraq and to make a war, but nobody then listened to John Paul II. So everybody came, everybody traveled to John Paul II. It was exactly like United Nations, and because everybody from different part of the world came to John Paul II, discussed with him, but then finally the decision has been done by politicians without taking into account the warning of John Paul II. And even this situation, nobody prepared action plan. And now the European Union decided to take the decision in a very formalistic way, yes? Quota for different countries. And it created, of course, a reaction of different countries, because it was taken without real knowledge of the situation of the country. Even the mental situation, different country. We have to take it into account when the European Union decides on such a common guideline. The mentality, as you said, mentality is different. And there is a different, how to say, culture to receive foreigners. There are some countries where, till now, for example, Poland, we are practically one nation country, one nation. We don't have minorities. We don't have people coming from different. It's a small, small minority. So such country like Poland should be prepared for opening. And now it's in starting point. But it's a long period of time. And it was a time for making, for discussing. But I think that this time was lost. And now when I discuss on the different approach of such countries like Spain, like Italy, even France, Western countries and Eastern countries, especially Central European countries, we are now in between. because we are in between the wave of immigrants coming from Africa, from south of the region, but we also should be open for the situation which is on our eastern border between Ukraine and Poland, for example, and then some other countries, Romania and others, because we don't know how will be the evolution of the situation between Russia and Ukraine. And it is for us a close neighborhood, and we also have to be open to receive them. For example, in the time of Maidan Revolution, we opened our hospital in eastern part of Poland and southern part of Poland for Ukrainians coming from Ukraine after the Maidan revolutions and the battles in Ukraine. It was also not easy because the special population in eastern part of Poland, eastern region of Poland, had a very negative memory concerning the role of Ukrainians in the Second World War, yes? But we decided, no, we have to overpass our reminiscence, and in this case, we have to open our borders and our hospitals, our schools for Ukrainians. We have a lot of Ukrainians at the universities. For example, in Lublin, it's a place where it's Catholic University, Lublin, but there are two universities, State and Catholic University, is close to the Ukraine borders. You can have the Ukrainian language on the streets, yes, many Ukrainians, sometimes different to say who are Ukrainian, who are Poland. But we are able to do it. And now some countries, they were, how to say, directed to the conflict in East, found themselves in a new situation coming from South and said, no, we are not prepared for being a country between two conflicts, yes? We have to have a clear policy how we can deal, how we cannot, what the government can offer us, what the European Union can offer us. And then after, we could observe the changing communique also done by Germany as concerned the role and the policy towards refugees. What does everything show? That exactly the immigration policy, which is now one of the crucial issues in Europe, is completely not developed, and there is no, how to say, clear guidelines what exactly should European Union done with this issue. And I think it is not only my thinking, but I think that it is also time to find a kind of cooperation, how far we can help in the territory in Africa and other countries when there is no open conflict war, how we can help them to keep the people there and give them possibility to develop a normal life in this territory. I know that it's not easy task, but it would be impossible to have everybody here in Europe, because otherwise we see what has happened in some Greek islands and other. We have to think how to cooperate and what kind of business of investment we can do in African territories to help them to preserve and to be in their own countries. But I think that this is the problem which is completely not well developed. So as I think, I try to concentrate myself, of course, on the issue we have in our own country after 25 years of transformation process, that we have to build our democratic thinking, our democratic institutions. But so for that reason, the main challenges for our countries are exactly to build the democratic mentality based on the rule of law, practical understanding of the what does democracy means, what you have in your societies. And then we also have to, our challenge probably will be for many countries in Central Europe, maybe not to Austria so much, but I think for many, how to live in multicultural society. Poland was, before Second World War, exactly multicultural cultural society. We had in our territory, because part of Ukraine, well, in our territory, we have Jews, a number of Jews, Orthodox, people coming even from Crimea, from different parts, in this sense. But now we have to learn how to open wider, that we are living in a globalized world, and we have to accept others with other culture. But till now, we discuss in our countries how we can, how to say, find a way for coexistence and finding a common language between different political groups in our countries. So for that reason, the situation is much more complicated. And as I said, I think that when we would like to think on the future and such a main issues, I think that are the main problems, but the old ones. So how we can define the principle of solidarity at the moment, what does means and what means principle of solidarity, and how we can define the principle of subsidiarity as we discuss the relationships between European Union and states and regional organizations. So I think that there are two crucial issues. We have to find the concrete example and concrete definition of the two principles, not only looking for such a general notions we know from the past, because they are the exactly new challenges for us. How we can define solidarity at the moment? What does it mean? What are the points important for solidarity in this moment? I think that when John Paul II would be here, he maybe will give us some points. Pope Francis also said it very clearly in European Parliament, but maybe we have to analyze it, yes, what does mean, how we can share our solidarity, not to be idealistic, yes, because idealism is not the best thing, how we can build policy. We have to be realistic, knowing our society and behavior, some reactions in our society, and despite the reaction, we have to try to find a new way for solidarity and for the new relations based on subsidiarity.
Si us sembla, ho deixaríem aquí. Si no hi ha més preguntes, thank you very much for being here with us, Mrs. Sukoka, i gràcies a tots vosaltres per haver vingut avui aquí a l'escola.
Do you think that it's possible?